say that some of you just experience what happens when an organization doesn't have a vital and living discussion of core values. Some of your friends stopped in the line and grabbed your bun and your coffee, and that is not okay. So I think we need to have a discussion here at our school. What are our core values? Can you grab a coffee bun whenever you can or not? It's just a small thing, but still, it shows something. Okay, that was just a personal reflection. We're going to let Mike in now. So with a couple more minutes overdue, but I don't think that will hamper you.
Okay.
Please.
Great. Well, thanks for the lead-in, Anders. I think it's very relevant because, you know, we're talking a bit today about the haves and the have-nots. And I was one of those people that did not have a coffee, so I feel a bit put aside by that, but it's okay. I'll go on. My name is Mike Debelak. I'm the Executive Director of Inclusive Business Sweden, and I'm quite happy to be back here because it was actually within this building, years ago when I was doing my master's degree here, where I heard about this concept called inclusive business with the base of the pyramid. And can I just have a show of hands, who has heard about this concept, inclusive business with the base of the pyramid? Okay, great, and I've got a few things to say. We talk about inclusive business with the base of the pyramid, but I guess we should start at the base of which pyramid? And that's where we'd like to start today. So when we talk about the pyramid, we're talking about the socioeconomic pyramid of wealth. And what this does is breaks down the world, the population of the world, into three large groups. At the top of the pyramid are the mature markets. And the mature markets are about 800 million people who are living on more than $55 a day. So that's most of the developed world, most of Europe, the US, Australia, where I come from, the people who can afford a good lifestyle and live well. Then you have the emerging markets. And the emerging markets are the group that live on between $8 and $55 a day. Most of this are the emerging middle classes coming out of the BRIC countries, which some of you may be familiar with, so Brazil, Russia, India, China, and increasingly through Africa. And over the last few decades, there's been more of a focus on these emerging markets, people seeing the opportunity of these middle classes. Traditionally speaking, business was more focused on this mature markets, you know, selling to people who could afford to buy stuff. But where we focus is what we call the base of the pyramid. And the base of the pyramid are the majority of people on the planet. 4.5 billion people living on less than $8 a day. Now, in the past, these people were considered to be charity cases, you know, the focus of where aid would go. There would be a lot of focus in trying to get handouts and support these people and feed these people. But what we also know about this group is that there is a lot of entrepreneurial spirit in these groups, because unlike a lot of you who will go out of university and be able to apply for a job, they don't have the same opportunity to go out and apply for a job. There aren't that many jobs out there. So these people have to use their own entrepreneurial spirit to create their own wealth, to get by in whatever way they can. Combined, they also have significant buying power. So as individuals, they may not have a lot of buying power. But when you consider that they are 4.5 billion people, combined there's a tremendous amount of buying power. So what we also know is that this is going to increase. By 2050, 85% of the world's population are going to be in these less developed regions. Right? While we look in Europe, population growth is pretty flat. Right? And you look in a lot of the developed world, that's quite flat. The populations are going to grow in these areas. And I'm sure a lot of you have also seen a lot of the videos and so forth from Hans Rosling. There is actually growing wealth. There are more people moving into the middle classes. So while the rich are getting richer, a lot of the poor are getting richer as well. So we're familiar with the pyramid, and what we've traditionally focused business on is trying to sell more things to the people in the mature markets. And to me, there's a problem with this because we're trying to sell more things to the people who don't really need any more stuff. I don't know about you, but I don't need more stuff in my life. At the same time, at the base of the pyramid, you have the people with significant needs. And I think it was great for Sam. I hate presenting after him because he's such a good presenter. But it was great for Sam to present on one of the needs, the need of energy and energy poverty. And these needs can be met through business models. So when we look on what inclusive business is with the base of the pyramid, or BOP as we call it, because we're in a university setting, we have a couple of definitions here. But the main idea is it's a private sector approach to meeting the needs of the base of the pyramid through commercially viable business models. Okay? So two things. It has to be commercially viable. It has to be a business. It's not charity. It's not even CSR. It's a business opportunity. And the second thing is it has to be linking in with the base of the pyramid and helping to alleviate poverty. And I think Trine was a very good example of a type of business doing that. So when we look at inclusive business, we're looking at the base of the pyramid as consumers. Consumers of food, of energy, of clean water, of goods. We're also looking at them as producers, particularly in agriculture, but increasingly in other areas, producers as well. And finally, we're looking at them as entrepreneurs, because they do have this entrepreneurial spirit. So when we talk about inclusive business, we talk about inclusive business with the base of the pyramid, not for the base of the pyramid. And what we see as what works the best is when you work with these groups and with local actors to develop these business models. So, when I was studying here doing my master's, I heard about this BOP concept and thought it was very interesting. So I read the book, The Fortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid, it was called, and they changed the terminology slightly. And one of the quotes from this book is, the world's most exciting, fastest growing new markets, it's where you'd least expect it, at the base of the pyramid. This is where you see this group with tremendous buying power, tremendous entrepreneurial spirit, and very little competition from traditional economies. Because the base of the pyramid have traditionally been outside of the mainstream economy. Right? If you look at the example of Trine, and if you look at the example of energy, their energy needs are being met to some extent by kerosene, by charcoal. You know, I think 1.3 billion people still use charcoal stoves to cook on, which has tremendous consequences for health and for the environment. So these needs have been met over time, but not really in the best way. And when we look at the business opportunity of the base of the pyramid, it's been valued at a $5 trillion opportunity. So $5,000 billion. And that's just looking at one side of the coin. You can't really see that here. But this is just looking at the BOP as consumers. Consumers for food, housing, transport, clothing, footwear, energy, ICT, and so forth. A $5 trillion opportunity. I would argue that there's even greater opportunity when you look at the base of the pyramid as producers and as entrepreneurs. And it's a largely untapped opportunity because business doesn't focus on that. It's also a significant growth opportunity. So in addition to population growth, we also see that there's tremendous growth in the wealth of sort of less developed economy. So developing economies are generally growing at 5-6% and so forth. In Europe, we're forecast to grow like 1.2-1.4% over the next few years. So when you look at where's the growth going to be, it's outside of the developed world. It's in these developing economies, and that represents tremendous business potential. So what one of the we work in a few areas here at Inclusive Business Sweden, but one of the main things we've been running with for the last couple of years is a program to try to support Swedish business in developing these business models with the base of the pyramid. And this is the Inclusive Business Co-Creation Accelerator. And we call it that because what we're trying to do is support co-creation. So what we found is that what doesn't work is if someone has a great idea that they think are going to solve poverty for the world and then they go try to sell that idea to the poor. Right? It's not about that. The most successful business models come through a process of co-creation, working with actors from those countries that understand the culture, the environment, the challenges, and developing solutions together. And that's what we've been doing. One of the major programs we've been working on the last few years, supporting Swedish businesses, including Trine and others, to make these business models successful. That's the role we play at Inclusive Business Sweden, as very much as enablers. So we don't start the businesses ourselves, but we support other businesses, we support collaboration, international partnering, and so forth, in order to help these business models become successful. So, you had a presentation this morning which you introduced to the Sustainable Development Goals, is that right? Everyone here familiar with those? Okay. Because this is one thing that these 17 goals are, I guess, are critical to where we are heading as a humanity. And Sweden is committed to these goals. 193 nations around the world are committed to these goals. The good news is we're number one. In Sweden, I could probably only say this as a foreigner, as an immigrant myself, but there has been a ranking done on which countries are closest to achieving the Sustainable Development Goals. And in this ranking, Sweden is 85% of the way there. So you're kind of on track. And that's great. And, you know, I think Sweden is in a fantastic position in that way. But what I see that is that we also have a global responsibility, because the commitment that Sweden has made to the Sustainable Development Goals is a global commitment. You haven't committed, you haven't committed to achieving these goals for Sweden. You've committed to achieving these goals for the planet. And a lot of the technologies and the solutions and the thinking and the structures you have could be of great value around the world. And this is really where we see great potential for inclusive business, if you like, in the export of some of these technologies, but also in the partnering around some of these challenges that are being faced. Like, I find it amazing as an Australian that you import garbage into this country because you haven't got enough garbage to do the district heating, right? And if you go to some of these developing countries, the one thing they're not short of is rubbish, but they don't see it as a resource. Sweden sees it as this tremendous resource. And if you can employ some of those same technologies to convert it into value, that could be an amazing thing. We're also part of the first generation that can end poverty and the last generation that could end climate change. So we've got some challenges ahead, but we've got a great base to start from, particularly here in Sweden, in working globally. What we've also set as part of the Inclusive Business Co-Creation Accelerator is six ambitions across six sectors where we see that Sweden has a strong capability, but that there are also tremendous needs at the base of the pyramid. So in agri-food, healthcare, water and sanitation, energy, textiles and clothing and ICT, aligned to six of the Sustainable Development Goals. we have set these ambitions of what Sweden can achieve in working with its partners. And we're probably in this group with Uniti and with Sam that we're, you know, overly ambitious and we've got you know, big plans to change the world, and we'd like to think of ourselves in the same bucket. So these are once again very significant ambitions, but you know, we're doing the best we can to get there. So one of the other exciting areas of this space is that there's tremendous space for innovation, because it is somewhat of a new market for traditional business, and because there are all the technologies that could be reapplied in the space in new ways. There's tremendous potential for energy solutions, as you've seen, for water and sanitation solutions. I mean, one of the things we've been working with recently is we have a new project working with toilets, which you don't think is a business opportunity, but in the developing world, it's a huge business opportunity. A third of the world's population, I think it's a third or a quarter of the world's population, don't have access to adequate sanitation. Healthcare solutions, mobile technology has really enabled a lot in developing markets. And there are more mobile subscriptions around the world than there are people. And we're even seeing smartphones to quickly penetrate in a lot of developing markets. So it's only a matter of time before all the poor have not just phones, but smartphones as well. Agricultural solutions, irrigation, so forth, biotech. And on the ground, it's been enabled a lot by microfinance, which you might be familiar with. So there's a lot of space here for innovation, for new business models, and it's a very exciting arena to be working in. And in Sweden, there's a few, quite a few companies that are working with this, that are using these type of technologies and they're thinking, both some of the startups, you know, Trine and others, that are really focusing and developing some very exciting business models and doing up, as well as, you know, Ericsson with their Technology for Good program, IKEA, the next generation program with you know, local entrepreneurs in India and in Pakistan. Tetra Pak has been working in this space for a long time. A huge part of their market is in the developing world. So there's some big companies working with it. There's a lot of startups emerging, coming out and doing a lot of fantastic work. And we'd like to support those organizations and new organizations to come forward and take on some of these challenges. So, now I'm going to give a bit of an advertisement. We're also looking for interns to work with us this year. Basically, we're looking for people who are motivated, self-driven, willing to learn. Able to work 50% over a 3-month period, to work unpaid or as part of your studies. Ideally, a background in business, development, or social sciences. Have a good working understanding of English and Svenska, and a sense of humor, of course. So if that sounds like you and you're interested in working in our field, please send an email with your CV to Carolina, my team, and or you can approach me later today. And that's a very brief introduction to inclusive business and the base of the pyramid. Thank you. Any questions? We are project funded, so we have, for each of the projects we work with, we get funding from Vinnova and Tilbeck Spoke at Asian Development Bank for specific projects. We are also an Idealförening, so we have members, organizational members, but that's a very small proportion of our total funding. So our funding is dependent on being able to get projects off the ground and up and running. That's also why we can't afford to pay our interns. Yeah, well, we cooperate somewhat with the Chambers of Commerce, not so much, sometimes with the Chambers of Commerce, the Swedish Chamber of Commerce in those countries, but also with the foreign Chambers of Commerce here. We also have worked quite closely with Chamber Trade Sweden, which is, if you like, an umbrella organization for the other Chambers of Commerce, particularly working with development issues. But it's really as a sort of an as-needed basis. And through that we work with quite a number of countries, but a lot of that being driven by either the projects or the businesses that that want to work with those countries.
So if you're an aspiring social entrepreneur, how far down the line do you have to be before you reach out to your organization? Can you be just having some ideas, or should you have done something before you come?
Yeah. No, we have a fairly open door policy. We're happy to hear if you have a business concept that you'd like to run by us. We're always open to provide some advice and tips. Obviously, it helps when you have a bit more of a concrete business model. But we've worked with some really fresh startups and had fairly open workshops with them. And as I said, you could also join as a member if you are a registered entity. And then we provide some additional services, information about access to funding and that sort of thing. You can be very early stage. And
Being a national center, do you have an outreach activity? Or
when you say outreach activity?
Seminars, educational?
Yeah.
Besides coming here, of course.
Yeah. We have an annual inclusive business forum that we... that we've held every year for the last 4 years. We try to focus more on trying to support action and innovation rather than just purely education, because there's actually a lot of stuff you can see online and publications and so forth about inclusive business and so forth. But we really try to support organisations that want to do something and want to do something successfully. But then we also do these sort of days presenting at universities and at different forums, and find ourselves doing that quite often.
When you did the poll here, not very many seem to have heard of this base of the pyramid concept. I was thinking, how can we activate universities and students in this, so we get a better understanding, have an impact on the teachers teaching here to include these kinds of business models and examples, but also have our students becoming more active, doing active stuff out there, supporting, helping, exploring.
Yeah, we've been that's been a little bit of an ongoing discussion. I talked to you before about that we want to, because we're based here in Göteborg, that we want to have Göteborg as a base for inclusive business nationally. And we've been having some conversation with the Västra Götaland region about how we can do that. And part of that equation is having a student engagement program. So we've been having discussions with Chalmers about the Challenge Lab, and about how the Challenge Lab could be used as a sort of a tool to engage students with a business in developing a business model.
Challenge Lab, by the way, is a master course that they offer at the Chalmers, working very interactively with urban challenges, having a lot of participation from the city, amongst others.
Yeah. So I don't know, I think we need to have that conversation, whether GU also has some sort of format which enables that. I know with Nicolas and the Center for Business and Society, and you had a while ago a conversation about that. So we'd really be open to looking at...
What would you say about the connection between base of the pyramid globally and the social challenges that we face here in many of our local urban settings.
We see that, at least from our perspective, because when you talk about inclusive business broadly, it can have different definitions, and you can talk about inclusive business within the, you know, within the community here and within the suburbs. We talk specifically about the base of the pyramid in developing countries because that's our niche, and we said that there are other organisations working here. At the same time, we see that there's a connection. We ran a program last year called the Gransk Erlesgrinde Entrepreneurskap, which is where we engaged with the immigrant community here in Göteborg to support them in developing concepts for inclusive business models with their home country. Because this is one of the areas where it's also a great opportunity to engage with these, you know, immigrant groups to develop these international business models. And we're having some ongoing discussions about doing that in some other cities around Sweden. So we see that there's a connection.
What was the result?
The result was that we had a couple of immigrants to develop their business models. So for example, there was one working with green technology in Brazil. We had a very short recruitment phase, and we ended up getting a lot of Syrians because a lot of Syrians were coming in and looking at these opportunities. And that was more difficult. And in the end, we adjusted the program a little bit because, you know, you can't do business with Syria right now. And so a lot of them focused on, you know, developing their businesses here in Sweden. And so we supported that. And a couple of those people have started businesses. But the main aim was actually to work with home countries. So when we do it again next time, we're going to make sure that we spend more time looking at getting more specific around the recruitment process to make sure it's people who have the opportunity to work with their home countries, like one of the participants did with Brazil.
So you're having discussions with Västra region, which is great. But have you also had discussions with the city of Gothenburg? Because of a lot of the challenges.
Not recently. Yeah.
Local because why we wanted you and Eric from Norrsken here is to show both of the actual companies that are doing stuff, producing services and products, and also the initiatives that are putting infrastructure in place, environments, hubs, enablers, which I think is really important these days. And I think it's also an excellent opportunity for you guys to engage. Of course, it's always fun to hear about Uniti and their fabulous car, and we can all envision that, but I think that these kind of infrastructural facilities is really important that we grow locally.
Yeah.
Because it sort of fosters a lot of activity and development. Locally.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's there is a tremendous opportunity. I think one of the good things about Gothenburg is it's quite an international city. It's a port city. It's got some international businesses here. And we are seeing a lot of, when we look at some of the logos up there, we are seeing a lot more, particularly startups coming out of Gothenburg with a focus in this space, and particularly in the energy space is one of the areas where it's quite strong here. So we like to try to support that and work locally and really support that development here. We're carrying that international outlook because that's where our focus is.
Any other questions?
Yeah. I was wondering, like you just said, your main take is to work with home countries and try to develop the situation there. What makes you think that being based in Sweden is the best way to do that? And my question leads to actually wondering if, do you think, like, the way you approach those issues, that is, in a certain perspective, kind of a top-down perspective, as like we from the top of that pyramid try to help the bottom, do you think that is the best, or at least the best way we have today.
Yeah. No, I think that's actually the worst way of doing it, the top-down approach. But that's why we're really focused on this co-creation, because we see that there are a lot of capabilities and technologies here, but this is not an export program, you know, that we're trying to support. What we do a lot of is trying to facilitate those type of organizations that have these capabilities and technologies, that they can find the right partners in those countries and work together with them. And as much as possible, which isn't always easy, have a bottom-up approach. And so we've had programs where we've taken, Swedish businesses, Nordic businesses, into those environments, to India, Bangladesh, and increasingly other countries, to try to enable that dialogue to happen. And that's why we try to support this idea of inclusive business with the base of the pyramid and really support the co-creation approach. Because absolutely, the one-way approach of developing a solution and thinking it'll work there and trying to sell it in is not the way to go. And it typically fails. Even when there are good intentions, it typically fails. We try to support that bottom-up approach as best we can, but also involving the technologies and the capabilities that come from this side. And in other areas where we work, so we have also another program with CEDA, which is the Innovations Against Poverty program, which we are running with some partners in Holland. And that is actually supporting a bottom-up approach to the development and support of innovation. So that is actually purely for businesses in Uganda, Zambia, Ethiopia, Cambodia, for example. And our partner organization has offices in those countries to enable that. So I take the question. I think it's definitely a bottom-up approach is much preferred.
In the current startup environment,
I think that there are entrepreneurs that, particularly startup entrepreneurs, that like Sam, for example, who want to do good first, and I think that is very important as a starting point, because I don't think a startup, if there's a startup that just wants to run a traditional business, we're not going to push them to go, oh, look at the base of the pyramid, because they've got their own things to deal with at the moment in time. They need to be focused on just getting their business up and running. But where we have more of a social entrepreneur who wants to do good and can see this as a business opportunity, then we like to try to support that. And with a startup, it makes sense to support it from a very early stage and to define an early, very early stage. The challenge becomes, because you have, individually very low purchasing power, is to try to get a business model going, which can be sustainable and with ideally with many people with very low purchasing power, and the challenge then becomes, how do you fund that in the early stages when it's not scaled? How do you finance that in the very early stages where you might just be working with hundreds before you get to the thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands? And that's where it gets really challenging. And a lot of the time there are mechanisms for development funding with those types of initiatives that can help get through that very early stages, and we help those sort of startups to identify, well, what sort of funding options might be available, and also we also sometimes help them apply for those type of calls.
Okay.
For funding. So to get them going in the early stage.
We have to stop there. Give Mike a big hand. Norrsken Foundation. Have we handed out the binder? Okay. So, for your participation, we need to send out some lists. No, you want to take all these. And as you understand, Erik is going to talk to half an hour now, and then we have a quick break, just a couple of minutes, and then we're going to have the talk afterwards. So please, take it away, Erik.
Okay. I'm going to talk about two things, two stories. That's it, nothing fancy. Who in here knows about Norrsken? You heard about us before. Okay, just so I know how to calibrate. So the first story is about me, sorry about that. The second story will be about Norrsken. So half a year ago, I was living in New York with my wife. We were living double income, no kids life. We were out having dinners every night. I was launching one of the most exciting companies in the world, Klarna, into the US. It was basically the best job you could have. It was so rewarding professionally and personally. It was the best time of my life. But there was something itching inside me that I felt for a very long time, and that was that I've had so much luck in my life. I won the Ovarian lottery, as Warren Buffett would say. I was born in Sweden, I was given free education, I was given free healthcare. Everything's been so easy for me if you compare it to 99% of the rest of the world. And so I started to feel maybe there's something I can do that gives back to the world a little bit more than I get. So I started to talk about, with Niklas, one of the founders of Klarna, about this. And he had the same idea, basically. He wanted to leave Klarna and do something to improve the world as well. And so we thought maybe we can use the experience from Klarna. We know how to scale companies really quickly, and we know how to launch them in new parts of the world. We know how to thrive in tech communities and so on. Maybe we can just go to charities or nonprofits and help them be more efficient or scale faster or solve problems in a better or different way. So we went out and talked to, like, I think 25 charities around the world. And most of them are amazing. They're driven by people with the heart at the right place. They're incredible wills and minds. But the problem with charities is so paradoxical. It's they're so short-sighted. Isn't that weird? They're trying to solve the biggest problems in the world, and they're doing it really in a really short-sighted way. So everyone who works in charities or nonprofits are donation. They know that they're donation-driven. If you're donation-driven, you have to have a certain bank account. In Sweden, at least, it's called a 90 account. If you want to have a 90 account, you have to have at least, or at the most, 25% overhead. If you can only have 25% overhead, you know that if you want to recruit a new head of donations or a new CPO, you're always going to go with a head of donations. And even if you know that you can make an investment today that will pay a huge dividend in terms of impact and save lives or whatever in 3 years from now, you can't make that investment because that would mean that you go above 25% overhead. So they're really short-sighted, which is weird. The other thing that we found was weird was that they're so afraid of risk. It's natural, because if you're the general secretary of UNICEF or Save the Children or whatever, and you take risk, even if you know that there's like a 99% chance that you will succeed and it fails in the end, you will be crucified in media. It will be the worst day of your life. You know, you will be on the front page of the news. How could you waste 10 million kroners on this stupid IT project when you could have, you know, dug wells in Africa or whatever? So they're really short-sighted and they take no risk. And from our perspective, working in normal corporations, the only way to be successful is to be long-term and take a lot of risk. That's the only way you can solve really complicated problems. They take time and you need to take risk. And then the third thing that we thought was really confusing was that how come they don't think about their opportunity cost at all? So if you're head of, let's say again, you're general secretary of UNICEF, there is no chance in hell that you're going to give money to Doctors Without Borders, even if you know that they need the money more than you do right now. Most charities and nonprofits in the world have incredible diminishing returns on their capital. because the projects that they fund are only for a year and they don't have the right setup and so on. But you never read about UNICEF giving money to Doctors Without Borders or whatever, just because they're not allowed to. And we wanted to build something that was long-term, could take a lot of risk, and was religious about opportunity cost. So Niklas is one of the founders of Klarna, and he has a lot of money. And he said, I want to make the world better with this money. Let's say that he wants to invest maybe 500 million into something. The opportunity cost of 500 million is super easy to calculate. There's a charity, or there's an organization called GiveWell. I really recommend you to have a look at it. That ranks all the charities in the world. And they go through every charity, charity by charity by charity, and look at how efficient are the money used. And they, out of 1,200 charities in the world, they can only recommend five charities. And at the top of the charity is something called Against the Malaria Foundation. And they can save one life for $4,700. That's the most efficient charity in the world. That's how much it costs to save one life. And so if you take 500 million kroners divided by $4,700, you get 10,000 lives. So what we do with that money has to be more efficient and has to make a bigger impact than 10,000 human lives. That's like a small Swedish city. So we can take the money today and save a small Swedish city from dying tomorrow. So we have to be super aware of our alternative cost. Everything we do. So, okay, that was the context, the background of what we set out to do. So we decided to found something called Norrsken. And Norrsken is a foundation. And we want to make the world a better place. It's as simple as that. And we want to do that by two ways. We want to create organizations that impact 1 billion people's lives in a positive way. There aren't a lot of companies or organizations that influence 1 billion people's lives. It's like Wikipedia, maybe Uber. There are like one or two, and we want to create those kind of companies. And the second is, to be brutally honest, I think most of the charities are doing a great job, but I think if I would ask you in here, you would say that they're super boring. Who the hell wants to work for a charity today? Can you see yourself growing personally, getting super challenging tasks, doing something super sexy, tech-related, when you can go work for Spotify or Vinge Advokatbyrå or McKinsey, right? That's where all the action is today. And we want to do something about that. So we want to help enable the next generation of rock stars and make it as fascinating and as personally rewarding and as fun to work for a company that does something well in the world as to work for McKinsey or whatever. So our hypothesis was that 10 years ago, if you go in here, by the way, thanks for having me here. I've never been here before. But 10 years ago, if you came here, or let's say 2006, the coolest job here, just before the financial crisis, I'm sure would be to be like a banker at Goldman Sachs, right? If you were a banker at Goldman Sachs, you would be the king of Handels in Göteborg. 5 years ago, the coolest thing you could be, if you were here at Handels, I'm pretty sure, was a superstar DJ. If you were on the stage next to Avicii pumping house to 10,000 people, you were a king of Handels, right? I think now, if you're the next Daniel Ek or the next Sebastian Simakowski, right now, you're the king of Handels. If you're building the next generation electric car or something like that, you're the king of Handels right now, or queen of Handels. And we want to make it as exciting to be the next social entrepreneur 5 years from now. If we've accomplished that, then we've really done made a difference in society. Because there's so many, like, you guys are amazing, and you've won the Ovarian lottery as well. And you can do so many things to improve the world. But I'm sure that you're going to choose another career path because it's more status related, it's more exciting. You can see that you're challenged in different ways by not choosing a company that currently is doing something to improve the world. There are some exceptional exceptions that we've seen earlier today. But I think the general view in society is that you can still get more development, more excitement if you go to Spotify than trying, for example. So we're trying to change this, and we're doing it in three ways. The first is that we've launched the biggest hub for social entrepreneurship in Europe. We launched it 2 weeks ago, and we have 250 members already. There's a line of about 1,000 people to join, and we will increase the space a little bit, but not by much. And the whole idea there is to curate the best group of people in the world, solving the biggest problems in the world. So we are combining people who are social entrepreneurs with pure tech talent, with artists, with designers, and hopefully that kind of group dynamic will create unexpected outcomes. We have no idea if it will, but we will try. So we'll really carefully curate this group of people and select some people who wants to make the world a really great place, and some people who just want to have fun, and some people who want to build, something exciting. And if we can get them together, maybe we can get something really exciting out of that. So that's the house. It's a big investment for us, but it's gone so well now that we're thinking maybe we should start, launch 25 more in the world. We'll see. But the ambition was just to have this one house first, but maybe Gothenburg next, we'll see. So that's one thing. Then the other thing that we're doing is our own initiatives. And our own initiatives are trying to solve some of the biggest problems that are facing mankind today that we don't see any good commercial solutions for. And those are corruption and personal growth. And just to put it in some sort of context, if we look at personal growth first. So 2016, around 650,000 people committed suicide. For the first time in the history of mankind, that's more than the number of people who died out of war, crime, and terrorism. 650,000 people. And at the same time, I think, it's just a hypothesis, but we think that more and more people are looking for a meaning in life and are just feeling lost in general. And the weird thing about this is that there are so amazing, the solutions out there are just so incredible. They're incredible. You can go to retreats or courses for a week or a weekend and really learn about finding yourself and what's the purpose of life. And the best aid is out there. If you feel suicidal, there are so many great therapists that you can go to. The problem is that they're so elitistic. So if you want to go to one of these courses, like UGL, for example, in Sweden, it's 80,000 kroners for a week. And no one can afford that except really fancy companies that send some of their employees there. So the people that really need these treatments are the furthest away from them. So we want to democratize those kind of learnings from those kind of camps and make it publicly available and spread it to as many people as possible. So we work together with Harvard and Cambridge and Karolinska Institutet so that they provide all the content and input, and we help build the platform, and we know how to scale things really quickly and spread it across the world. Because we have no idea how to help someone who's suicidal, but we know how to build products really quickly. And if we combine that, maybe we can get it out to the world really quickly. The other initiative was to combat corruption. And if you look at corruption, it's like a wet blanket over growth in so many of the base of the pyramid that we talked about. And what's really interesting there as well is that there are some organizations that take care of corruption on a really high level that are absolutely fantastic. OCCRP, I don't know if you know them, is one of the best investigative journalistic networks in the world. They uncovered the Telia stories. There are networks that can take care of the Panama Papers in great ways. But the most of the corruption that you see is very local. It's the local municipality politician who takes a bribe in order for you to have your road all the way to your house, or a cop that takes you off the street and you have to bribe them to let him go. And there are no great solutions to report that. So we're building an app which is kind of like Instagram on the front end and Wikipedia on the back end, where you have editors and volunteers who really are passionate about solving these problems. And then we collaborate with some of the biggest media partners in the world to put pressure on the institutions where corruption is prevalent. So that's the second initiative. And we fund these ourselves. We appoint CEOs and we build the teams all by ourselves. Then the third thing, which is I think the most exciting, because we're like super beginners, we are amateurs. We've been around for 4 months. We have no idea how to do this, so we're learning every day. Thankfully, we have our third leg, which is investments. And so what we do is invest in entrepreneurs who we really, really believe will solve the biggest problems in the world. And the way that the UN wants to improve the world that you heard is basically they say, here's all the problems in the world. There are so many that we have to divide them in some different areas. So they say, okay, let's come up with a number, 17. So here are 17 areas. The problem with each area is that it's so wide that it's impossible to even think about how do I even solve this problem, because it's such a broad target. And when you go out and start working, you'll know that if you have the right targets, it's so much easier to actually achieve them. When it's fluffy and big, it's super difficult. And so that's the way that the UN approaches. They say, okay, we have 17 targets, and then we'll give a torchlight to someone who's done a great career at the UN, and we'll throw that person into a dark room, and that person will look for solutions. There's a solution that might solve my problem, and there's a solution that might solve my problem. And it's, at best, our hypothesis at least, is that that's very inefficient. At worst, it's counterproductive. So we take a completely different approach, just inspired by VCs that we've engaged with throughout our careers, and that's to just look at the entrepreneurs. Because if you look at what makes companies successful, it's usually four things. It's the team, it's the product, it's the idea, and the execution. But what matters the most is always the team and the product. And so we just look really hard at trying to find the people who are super passionate about solving a problem that they're themselves really annoyed with. And then what that problem is doesn't matter that much to us. It could be whatever, as long as it's one of the as long as it's something that will solve a problem that the UN has said is one of their sustainable development goals. So we've invested in solar energy, very similar to Trine. We've invested in how to help newly arrived people in Sweden integrate faster. We've invested in food waste reduction apps, super exciting stuff. We've invested in how to make primary healthcare more efficient. There's no common theme in our investment other than that the entrepreneurs are rock stars. They're so amazing. So that's what we do. We run the house, we have these initiatives, and we try to build these investments and support them as much as we can. And we're right now, I started 2 weeks ago, by the way. But we tried to move as quickly as possible. So I think, just to summarize, what makes us different and what makes us complement the existing nonprofit sector and the corporate sector is that we take the best from both worlds. We are so focused on getting things done, making things happen, which I think sometimes is lacking a little bit in the nonprofit sector. Super religious about getting things done. It's like deadlines are holy, and you have to work hard to solve hard problems. It's that easy. But then we also want to make the world better. And if you can combine those two aspects, we think that really awesome things can come out of it. Maybe we can impact 1 billion people positively. Maybe we can create the next generation of rock stars. Maybe not, but at least we're going to try. Yeah, that's Norrsken. Oh, I forgot something, by the way. So everything that we do is software-driven. So we invest in companies that we can help scale super quickly. So software. It's really important for us. Like building a car, it's so difficult because you have hardware and stuff. We know nothing about that. But otherwise, it seems like such an exciting project. Any questions?
You spoke about the targets that you're talking to. How do you measure that you've affected 1 billion people?
Yeah, it's a good question. We don't know yet. We're really focused on data and KPIs. But the problem right now is that you have some of the some of the projects that we invest and fund are really easy to measure, because you can see, like, okay, we save one person's life here, for example, or we distribute one malaria net or vaccine and poll or whatever. But if you measure how we reduce corruption or increase transparency or increase equality, it's really difficult to weigh that against the saved life today. So we're developing that together with McKinsey and some other folks that are helping us. Because no one has really nailed how to measure it in a good way and how to compare the different areas in a good way. So we'll see. Hopefully we'll find a solution that we can share with everyone. But right now we don't really know. But it's like the crux of the problem, how to measure it in a good way.
What is your objective for Norrsken in 2018? Let's say 31st of January.
Right. So, So there are, different areas. One obvious area is just right now our budget is like 50 million per year. We have maybe 10 different investors that want to help out. So we'll increase that to, maybe 2 billion or something like that. But we'll see. So that's one objective. The other is just to recruit the right people. We're building our investment group, and we have some exceptional people coming in, but that takes a lot of time. Hopefully we have between 10 and 15 more investments. Right now we've started out in Stockholm because it's just a market that we know better. It's easier for us to judge the entrepreneurs. But next year we will do a couple of investments in Africa, just to start learning, in Kenya and maybe Tanzania, we'll see. And then getting the measurements in place is a big goal for this year. Hopefully we'll have an MVP both for Clarity, the corruption initiative, and 29K, the personal development and growth app as well. So super ambitious targets. But luckily, we have like the best team in the world. It's absolutely insane. So if it would be up to me, we would fail completely. Right. So we want the organizations that we invest in to be long term, because we think that that's the best way to tackle some of these difficult questions. And they can be long term either by being sustainable themselves in a business model. That's great if they are. But they can also be long term by having a setup that will allow them to get grants long term as well. But out of so we've done 6 investments. 5 have great business models. They just happen to make the world better as well. And one is, there is no clear business model right now, but there might be a half a year from now. But we think that there's no contradiction between making the world better and making money at the same time. Yeah?
It sounds quite easy when you say all this stuff. 2 weeks ago we had this. Do you think this is a trend from all the previous startup companies that a lot of people are going to go into?
It's an interesting point that you make. Like, starting a company and being an entrepreneur is probably the most difficult thing anyone can do. It's just so much hard work, and it's like, I think Tim Ferriss said, it's like eating glass and staring down into the abyss at the same time. You're constantly faced with this like Armageddon scenario, and it's really eating you up from inside. So it's definitely not easy. So I've been super motivated my entire life. I've just worked really hard. I like that. But when Friday comes and I know that Saturday is the next day, it's a pretty nice feeling in my body, right? I might have to work a little bit on Saturdays, but it's still nice that it's Saturday because I don't have to see the office me. But now, today, when there's a Saturday, I just long for Monday. Isn't that weird? It's insane. But I work with something that's so meaningful on a deeper level for me, that I can work like all the time and it feels fun. But it's not easy. It never is. But it feels meaningful in a way that work has never done before, or school or anything. It's just pretty dope. Yeah.
Do you think that you had to go through that career in New York and do this cool job to find that meaning? Or
yeah, so for me personally, I've always, like, I've reflected on this my entire life. I've always been really interested in politics, and but I've just never found the right organization to work with. And then I, getting really personal here, so I've had a birthmark that they thought was cancer, and in the period when I didn't know if it was cancer or not, I was like, okay, maybe I'll die in 3 months or in a week or a year from now, and if I do, will I be really happy with what I've accomplished? Do I feel satisfied with who I am, what I do? And the answer wasn't super uplifting, so I felt that I have to do something differently. Then it turned out that I actually had cancer, but in a different place. And so I wake up every morning now and I ask myself, like, okay, so if this is the last week or last month or last year, what would I do today? And the answer to that is Norrsken. But it took some time for me to get to that point. And I honestly don't think that you will add the most value in life by jumping straight from school into an organization like ours or an organization like the United Nations or whatever. I think you will add more value long-term if you really learn to code, if you learn to scale businesses, if you learn to add value in some way, and then bring that to the nonprofit sector. So yeah, I think it was super valuable for me. I would never have been here otherwise. I wouldn't have met Niklas. I wouldn't have worked for at Klarna if I hadn't studied at Harvard and so on. So it was really important for me to do that. But that was just my path. I'm sure any path is as good. But don't be like stressed about making the world better today. You're so young. You have so much time to do that. As long as you're open for the opportunity when it comes. thanks for listening. And if you stop by Stockholm, come by the space. Let me know if you want to come by the space, because it's only for members. I just realized, and they put up the gates today. So, but let me know. We're always looking for the best people. This is not for everyone. It's really difficult to get in here. The entrepreneurs that we support are, so this month I think we had 150 applications from different companies that want to be part of this, and we were maybe investing in one of them. So we're really looking for the stars that we think can make a difference in the world, and have the grit and tenacity to build exceptional organizations. But let me know if you want to come by. I'm super happy to show you around. I'm at eric@norrskenfoundation.org if you want to reach out. Yeah. Thanks for listening, guys.
Excellent speakers here today. Thank you so much for coming and sharing. Thank you. And thank you. And Sam, where are you?
Here I am. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And Bert-Ola. Oh, he's outside. You can get him for the Okay. Oh, Mike! I have one. Excellent. Irving, thank you to the whole of you guys. You've been super engaged and asking a lot of questions, and you really made this day. And also, I would like you to just give us a couple of minutes now before Alan Gould, a master student of international business and trade, which I'm really happy volunteered to facilitate this talk that we're going to have after like 5-7 minutes get the sofa up and get the technique good order and all that. And we're gonna have a little bit more of a personal chat with these guys, asking them about what the journey and a little bit. So I think it's gonna be very interesting. So if we just take 5 minutes, we arrange something. It's gonna be around 45 minutes. Talk, right? Yeah. Okay. Thank you.